I'm Lori McNichols for the Beltlantic Mobile Fan Highway Patrol.
Irish in the Morning, 2020 Sports, with Mark Breeze.
The fact this week.
Takes two of them here, Michael.
Yep. Quiet.
Three practice, mate.
Oh, he's got it out there left.
He's in trouble, though. He's in trouble.
Yes, he is.
Oh, he got it too far out there left this time.
He made good contact, though, Michael.
He made very good contact.
He hit a spectator, gentlemen.
A lucky eight for the I-Man. Good morning. Mike Breeze.
What are you talking about, a lucky eight?
Mike Francesa, Chris Russo with the call.
I mean, that's unbelievable. You're
WFAN in New York. The one-hole challenge for Don Imus yesterday on the
should have been a seven, by the way.
Of the lucky elbow.
A lucky eight?
The I-Man fortunate to get an eighth. Fourth shot approaching the green caromed off a woman's face onto the cart path. If it had not hit the woman, it could have gone hundreds of yards past the hole.
Oh, well, that's just outrageous. I mean,
that's silly.
You are so upset because you...
You bet I'm upset.
You know what would have happened if you'd have played that hole? You'd have shot an eight.
I might not have come close to an eight, for crying out loud.
Absolutely.
There's something wrong in the world when this happens. Many predicted a 20 or worse. My own prediction was a 23. And golf commentator Chris Russo had advice for those who predicted a bad hole.
You should just go home with, you know, basically their heads between the tails and just stay undercover all week and don't be noticed, don't talk to anybody.
Yeah, my wife had never heard him on the radio, and she said the following, what language is he speaking?
I don't know. Well, I mean, had no reason to put his head between his tails.
Well, the woman I hit, by the way, this charity was named after Stephen Cox, who died of cancer when he was 33 years old. I hit his mother.
No.
But I mean, the ball, I hit it 160 yards, and the ball dropped. And it grazed her cheek.
Yeah, as it was.
The ball was rising.
No, the ball was
the
not
ball
rising.
Was, the ball was at its absolute... It was about to make contact with the ground again.
Yes. And she was... Because the crowd was lined up and down the fairway, which I thought was kind of...
Well, that's a typical gallery at the 18th hole of a major tournament.
Yeah.
I know that, but I mean... Well, here's the thing. I wasn't nervous at all. I didn't even hear the crowd. I was very focused. I tell you, that pro there is a great pro.
Isn't he?
Bob Moragas is a great pro.
Excellent golf temperament.
Yes.
Exactly. Exactly. That teaching temperament.
The thing he told me is that just have to plant your feet and don't swing hard. And, and keep your wrist straight.
Keep your head down.
As crazy as you can. Keep your head down. Well, I didn't have any problem doing that.
Nope. Obviously. Look at the result.
Man.
Oh, horrible.
No, I know.
Awful day.
I'm not surprised. Absolutely not.
Well, like I said, how hard is this game?
I mean, it's not hard at all.
It's obviously not hard at all.
Give any credit to the people who supported you from the very beginning of this?
Hmm?
The people who believed in you from the get-go?
Here's the thing. You are such a show business phony that I don't take anything. I mean, if my wife says something to me, I believe it. If Charles says something to me, I believe it. If Fred says something to me, I believe it. But you have no credibility because you suck up and to everybody. And everything everybody does is always the greatest.
5-on-3 putt, I said.
It's like when Larry was coming in here drunk every day. You were saying, oh, you sound great, babe. It's not a problem. You know?
You look good, too.
You look good, too. Had these big bags on his eyes. Remember how you used to use that?
5-on-3 putt, I said. Vinny Pepitone wrote it down on the scorecard. While you were on the driving range hitting those soaring 4-yard dribble shots.
Oh, no, I missed a couple shots on the because I was still tied. I had to loosen up here.
And what do I get from my loyalty and support? I'm sitting in the cart by the practice range. I say, you can do this.
I should have two-putted.
Well, you should have two-putted, but you should have gotten a penalty stroke for hitting that old lady.
Why?
That was a Gerald Ford moment.
No, it wasn't. That's idiotic. The ball didn't careen off. The woman, unfortunately, the sweet thing, she was standing 170 yards away up there by the fairway. She was they were standing right along the fairway. And the ball dropped there and hit her in the cheek.
It's her fault.
It was her fault, not my fault.
Yeah.
You're at a golf course. Get out of the way.
5-on-3 putt, I said, and you can do this, I say. And what do you say to me?
I say you're a
phony. You're a fat a-hole.
You're
that's
a
what
fat,
you said to me.
Yeah. You're a fat a-hole.
Oh, that's
funky
nice.
You. You're a fat weasel.
You're a fat a-hole.
Charles is the one who, in writing, predicted I would do well.
Yes.
And Deidre believed I'd do well. But Deidre only claims I did well because she had both fingers crossed and her legs crossed. So...
just like in the
don't go,
the
don't
night.
Even go there. Just don't even go there.
Yeah.
But my, at least my wife was man enough to watch. You couldn't even right. watch.
Well, you're right. You're right. I admit it.
Poor Charles. Charles is so loyal. He's sick as a dog. Drives 2 hours or hour and a half, whatever it is, out there to see this thing.
But it was fun. I was glad. It's unbelievable.
I am a gifted person. That's all.
You're somehow the luck is with the I-Man. It's the luck of the I-Man at any of these kinds of events. I've seen you do it time and again, so that's why I knew it.
Would you have been nervous playing in front of all those people?
Absolutely.
You'd have been a wreck.
I would have been. I couldn't have done it.
Of course not. You're choked.
No, there's no question.
What did the I-Man do?
I've seen you do it. Many
what did the I-Man do? Like Sherman going through Atlanta.
Stormed the AT.
Absolutely.
Get me out of here. You do want me, get me at the show. But if you don't want me, don't leave me on now. But if you need me, show me that you know. And when I'm feeling blue, and I want to, there's just one thing that you should do. Just give me some time, I'm a morning.
Cup of coffee of today's New York Times sports section and look for the ad to find out the hour we'll be doing today's contest during the Mike and the Mad Dog program. Then listen for your chance to win all the tickets.
It's classic sports trivia, Mike, and your chance to win all those great tickets from the New York Times and the fans. Sports Radio 66 WFAN in New York.
Amos in the morning, 2020 sports with Mark Free. Do it, boy.
I'd go with him right now. About trying to sign a deal with him right now before he gets to the green.
Bob is long time caddy.
He ran it up there, and Don Imus is on the green in five. I'll go on the green in five, Don. One of the tremendous golf performances in this century.
The greatest triple bogey in the history of golf. Love good morning. Good. Mike Brainwood Sports, the sportscast sponsored by your Chrysler and Plymouth dealer. Mike Francesa, the call on WFAN New York. As unfortunately the world is now aware, Don Imus firing a 3-over, 8 on the par 5, 18th at Fiddler's Elbow.
Tap in 8.
It's an 8.
It's a tap in eight.
So there's no difference between a tap in eight and a
60-foot. I understand that, but I mean,
but it was a double bogey and a half.
Yeah, so I shot a 7.5, and everybody predicted I was going to shoot a 15.
I predicted 23.
Yeah, well, what happened?
While the I-Man's golf game was smooth sailing, the same cannot be said for the radio broadcast of this event, which was heard worldwide, and again, began here on WFAN in New York with Francesa and Chris Russo.
I think the crowd is absolutely stunned.
Okay, but... Wait a second.
I need a mic. Let's go, Dick.
And I'm just now walking down the fairway, looking very confident. Solid tee shot, and that, of course, was perhaps the key to this entire hole.
Oh.
And as you walk...
That crack WFAN engineering committee.
They're unbelievable. I can't even walk with them, dog, because I can't have a microphone.
You cannot walk with them?
No, because they don't have this wired upright.
So what's going to happen here?
Hey, can we get there maybe before he takes his next shot, guys, okay?
Yeah.
Jeez.
By the way, Francesa nearly had a heart attack trying to keep up with
him. Yeah. Hey, Doc. We'll get an interview as soon as I catch
him. Hey, Doc. I love Francesa.
He's the man.
He really is a great guy.
Yeah. Yep, he was sick yesterday.
He was sick as a dog. He really is. He's
I got some bad ding-dongs or something.
29 after the hour here in the Amos Morning Program.
One more thing.
Mr. Francesa is a little overweight, isn't he?
He's a little heavy, but he's a big man.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. He's a huge across. Yes, he is. Yes,
you know, is. And you couldn't... And by the way, I heard your play-by-play, right? And you kept hoping each time I'd take a shot that I'd hook it into the woods or...
Do you want me to lie and be a phony? No. I wanted you to have a 23.
Yeah, well, I admire that, frankly. All right, go ahead.
Monday Night Football, Jacksonville beat Pittsburgh 30-21.
Man, what happened to the Steelers?
Steelers running back Jerome Bettis was pleased.
It's a tough loss, but I think we gain a lot from it because we show how tough we are.
Yep, and they're 1-2.
Yeah. You bad, baby.
Wake up.
Of course, the Jets are 2-2, and they're on their way, but don't ask Bill Parcells if he's trying to send a message to the rest of the NFL.
It isn't about messages. I love that one.
I mean, I'm not being a wise guy. There's no messages. I'm trying to win the game. It's not about a message. Message? Yeah. This isn't any FTD florist.
I love this guy. Who asked that question?
We're trying to find out. There was a reporter from the station who was present at the press conference, but we haven't been able to get a hold of him.
I mean, one of the more idiotic questions ever asked of anybody.
Trying to send a message to the rest of the...
Who asked Bill that question, Francesa?
I don't know, Don. I talked to him this morning, and I apologize. I wasn't listening to the last hour of the program when you guys just called. I was on the phone, but I asked him, and he said he didn't know the guy's name. Clearly one of the dumbest questions I've ever heard.
Guy's trying to win football games.
It's unbelievable. I don't understand it, but I don't know.
Let me tell you who asked it. Let me tell you what happened yesterday. By the way, you did a fine job, and I appreciate you coming out there because you were sick. And I'm sure all the people who raised all that money. So if they raised in that whole event yesterday, well over $500,000, you know.
Wow. Yeah, it was unbelievable. And I hate to say this because I hate to actually have to come on here this morning and seriously compliment you because it's like such a hard thing to do.
What?
You know, but you were so good yesterday that it was actually scary.
Yeah.
I mean... You actually hit the ball straight.
Yeah.
You hit a 5-iron 190 yards.
Yeah.
190 yards.
If I hadn't been abandoned by your producer, Bob Gell.
He was doing an MSNBC remote at the time when you missed. Mm-hmm. And that was a choke on your part.
No, it wasn't.
You know, you were great, Don, but to miss an 18-inch uphill putt for a 7, the difference between a 7 and an 8 is a lot of glory, and that was, on your part, a terrible choke.
No, it wasn't. What are you talking about?
You're on a dance floor in 5.
No.
3 putt.
I didn't choke. I just didn't take enough time.
Choke, Don.
I did not choke.
Don, an 18-inch putt.
I rushed it.
Don, the lady you hit with the ball could have made that putt.
I should have hit you with one of my clubs. All right, well, I hope you feel better.
Thank you, Don, and you really were unbelievable.
Oh, stop. Don't stop.
You did look like Katherine Hepburn playing that hole, I'll tell you right now.
It's 32 after the hour. Mike Francesa here on the Iverson Williams program. He'll probably be on this afternoon on the radio station. If you're in New York, you can listen to him. If you're not, you're not going to hear him. What else, Breen?
One baseball note. Giants beat the Padres 11-5. Dodgers were idle. So San Francisco, with a 2.5 game lead, their magic number is 4.
What time is the Dodger game today, do you know?
No idea.
Of course not.
And the Giants game, do they play at night today or in the afternoon?
I don't know.
We have no idea.
No way.
Let me see if I can figure it out.
Okay, I have DirecTV, the satellite. Why would I want to watch that?
I don't know.
Well, I'm kind of interested.
When you can get the recap tomorrow morning.
Yeah, that's a good point.
The Giants and the Rockies at 9:05.
There you go.
Right. P.M. Eastern.
Mm-hmm. 33 after the hour. What time does the Marv Albert trial start? Who are we going to get the report on it tomorrow?
That's a good question. Maybe Jay.
Yeah. Maybe check in with him. He was great.
Yeah, he was excellent.
He was wonderful.
Who else is covering it? Let's find out.
Excellent plan.
Yeah.
Okay.
Brilliant.
I like to give different people
their shot.
Their shot. Yeah,
no. I'm in, bro. Yeah.
I'd rather hear Jody Applegate talking about that stuff myself.
Maybe Jody will.
Yeah.
I don't know, man. I don't want to hear about it.
Have you never put on a pair of panties?
No, I have never put on a pair of panties.
Oh, well, of course, but...
Yeah, okay.
That isn't going to have
you did?
Oh, my God.
No, you idiot.
You have worn panties?
No. Oh, I was just kidding.
Sure.
Right. Okay. I was kidding.
Sure.
What are you looking at?
Put your pants down right now.
Absolutely.
Full of that. Oh, my God.
No, I'm
no respect.
I'm kidding.
Of course.
Well, what are you?
Well, I don't know. The boys, and then you got snagged.
Yeah. That's just idiotic. It's 25 till the hour. Here on the Iverson Winning Program tomorrow, Mary Madeline. On Thursday, who does wear panties.
Yeah.
And then on Thursday, Senator Arlen Specter. We will be in Philadelphia, and then the mayor of Philadelphia, what's his name?
Rindell.
Rindell. Yeah. Bob Rindell, the mayor
Tyrone.
Of Philadelphia. Tyrone Rindell, whatever his name
is. That's my tag. That's what I'm going with.
Mr. Rindell, the mayor of Philadelphia, he'll be on.
Yeah.
And somebody reported on a Marv Albert trial, and we haven't decided who we're going to get yet. Is Fred Graham covering this? Oh, hey, I know who you got to get. Oh, this guy's great. It's the kid who used to be on Court TV.
Nice looking kid. I think he's got a rug.
Murphy.
Coincidentally. Murphy. Right.
Yeah.
He was on MSNBC. He was the other guy on MSNBC last night with John Gibson.
Oh.
All right.
Sorry.
Or maybe the other guy. Well,
at least one person was watching.
You.
He was kind of scary looking.
I watched him.
No, he's not.
Is he?
Yeah.
He used to be with Court TV. He's a great reporter.
Right.
He's a great reporter.
So, in other words, you were unhappy with Jay Monahan.
No, Jay was fine.
It's not what we're getting from this.
No,
we're spreading it around, aren't we?
Jay sucks, huh?
No, Jay doesn't suck. I mean, just...
Spreading it around.
Okay,
fine.
Spreading around the gravy.
If I could remember the guy's name, ask Terry. Call Terry and find out what the deal is.
Right away.
How would you like to be...
We're going to be in the food court area there. So y'all can come down and see us?
Fabulous.
Yeah. And it's going to be fun. So, I was talking to Mike Lupica, the sports columnist, novelist.
Excuse! All right, Bill and Celia.
Hi.
Let's see how many excuses you can think of for not receiving a page. Celia starts.
Okay, my pager was turned off.
I'm sorry.
Miss a couple days and take a day off today, get himself organized as we talk to you about the world of sports. Dave Campbell will join us sometime.
End to end. Non.
Imus in the morning. 2020 sports.
One ball and two strikes. Hernandez bent at the waist. He has the sign from Johnson. Comes set. Here's the pitch to the plate.
Swing and a miss. He struck him out. And the Giants have won the ball game 4-3.
San Francisco's magic number is 2. Good morning. Mike Brainwood Sports. Ted Robinson to call KNBR. Giants win coupled with the Dodgers loss at home to the Padres. And San Francisco 2.5 games in front with 3 to play. The winning hit last night, a home run from Brian Johnson. Top of the 9th inning. Johnson had a plethora of emotions.
The mix of relief and jubilation, I think. It's really a great tranquilizer, but at the same time, it pumps you up, too. So it's kind of a weird feeling.
Brian, a young man not afraid to show his sensitivity, something we need more of in this day and age.
I like that, the use of the word plethora, Mike.
Do you like that?
Yeah.
I'll have one big word every hour.
Oh, great.
Other scores, Philadelphia Phillies won. They beat the Braves 5-1, so the Phillies gained some ground. They're now just 34 games out of first place. The big redhead homered again. Mark McGwire, number 55, and the Cardinals lost to the Reds. McGwire has 4 games remaining. American League home run leader Ken Griffey Jr., he's moved up to number 1 in the batting order. He's leading off, so he gets more at-bats. But he went 0-3, so he still has 55 with 3 games left.
No darn.
Toronto Blue Jays fired their manager.
What?
Cito Gaston canned with only 4 games remaining in the season. They could have let him go until the end, but no, wanted obviously to embarrass the man. Gaston won 2 World Series managing the Blue Jays, but they've had 4 straight losing seasons. When he learned he was fired, Gaston took a shot at Blue Jay management.
You know, they wouldn't know a baseball if it hit him in the lip.
Oh, you idiot.
Yes, sir, he's a bitter man, and you can't blame him.
And you're a pencil neck geek.
Finally, Ryder Cup, golf's most compelling event, begins tomorrow in Spain. It's the United States versus Europe. United States this time with Tiger Woods leading the charge. Woods was asked the key to his success.
I'm pretty strong. I only have 6% body fat.
Glad to hear that from Tiger. Meanwhile,
God, I hate that kid.
Golfing legend Don Imus will have a special Ryder Cup preview a little bit later on in the program.
I don't think so.
And how to attack those par fives in Spain. And that's sports. I'm Mike Breen.
It is 30 minutes past the hour, and I am Imus the Money, and the Imus the Money.
We must be able to empathize and understand each other, sensitive to and respectful of our differences.
I'm fine.
Unfortunately, I fear this will never happen, because no matter how much progress we may engender, I don't think black people will ever understand the crazy stuff white people do when they having sex. Case in point, Marv Albert. In the transcripts of the phone call the defense prevented as evidence, the identity of the alleged victim is protected so far by referring to her as A.B. But with all these new revelations coming out about Marv's bizarre sexual appetite, A.B. could very well stand for Abe Vigoda. Apparently, Marv liked to have threesomes with two ladies and a maid, which at first didn't appear to be all that apparent until we found out that Marv was one of the girls. Ain't a black man in the world who's gonna put on some Victoria's Secret, except maybe Michael Jackson, but he don't exactly count as black or man. What is it with you white people? Why is it just normal, plain old man on top, fire in the hole, have the cigarette, roll over and go to sleep, knocking boots, good enough for y'all? Why does the freak nasty with you got to be so freaky and so nasty? Why do you need to turn getting busy into something out of Fellini movie? You'll never hear about a black man who couldn't get aroused unless he wore a diaper and some midget and nipple clamps and a pirate hat, seeing him with tapioca. It's only white people who into all these shoe fetishes, rubber fetishes, bestiality, using their hiding as hamster habitat, pedophilia, coprophilia, and in the case of Ruth Messenger's husband, necrophilia.
There's radio.
That's the single smartest person I've ever met.
Very, very wonderfully reasoned.
Good.
Yeah, it works.
Well, I do. I want to be honest about it. I have enormous respect for Sidney Zion, and I've been a fan of his for years. You know, and in other words, I've read his columns.
Yeah.
And I did feel a little badly about telling him I would, and now decided I'm not going to. But he's just going to have to deal with it. At least I'm being honest about it.
Oh, absolutely.
So.
In stiffing Mr. Zion, you're being honest, at least. And I admire that. I admire your candor.
What do you mean, in stiffing Mr. Zion?
Well, in not doing what you said absolutely to Mr. Zion that you would do.
Well, yeah.
And now in leaving him hanging out there, appearing the fool.
No, because I the first person I called was Mr. Zion and put him on the radio.
I'm
and on television.
I'm busted. I'm kidding you.
Connie McCord. Connie McCord. Her name's Connie McCord.
Or as Marv calls her, the frog.
You can win a Sony Web TV for the best impression of Marv Albert. Good morning, Paul.
I'm getting ready to go into the trial here in Virginia, and of course, very pleased with the results from yesterday.
God, that's a great
that
impression.
Is great.
Oh, that's
thing.
A great, great. You bring Rob up. Rob, do you hear that?
Yes.
Well, what? Oh. Rob, say hi to Paul.
Hi, Paul. Hi, Rob, you bastard. Rob, don't be upset. 99 out of 100 is not bad. Oh, bite me.
If your radio light sucks in the morning, you're listening to Imus in the Morning.
Hey, Paul.
Yes, so I'm at.
You went. Paul.
Yes.
Do you want to?
It's the New York Knicks versus the New York Dominatrix.
Do you want a Web TV terminal from Sony?
I would love to have that because from now on I will be watching TV instead of broadcasting on it.
Yeah. Guys, great, man.
Sports Radio 66, WFAN.
All right, let me tell you about a very special event that everyone should attend. The Stanford Center for the Arts is hosting my man,
Delbert McClinton for one night only at the Palace Theater in Stamford, Connecticut on Saturday, October 11th at 8 p.m. Here comes
Imus in the morning. 2020 sport.
Breyer waits. Now he swings and drills it into left. Is it fair? It's gone. 55. 55. 55. 55. A line drive home run. That's 55 big ones.
The strapping redhead goes deep. Good morning, Mike Greenwood Sports. Jack Buck with a call on KMOX Radio. Cardinals lost the game, but who cares? One of sports' largest and most attractive redheads flexed his glistening muscles last night, sending a baseball into orbit for his 55th home run.
Mike, we were thinking here, me and Charles were talking about...
Don't say it.
What?
Go ahead.
These allegations against Marv and his preferences in terms of men.
So McGuire hit his 55th home run last night for the Cardinals.
Who doesn't like a man with a big penis? I mean,
when you think about it.
Sure.
Give it the option.
Yeah. Speaking of that, McGuire...
Something wrong with that pitch.
That will be fine. Go ahead.
McGuire has been emotional during his pursuit of Roger Maris, and that was the case last night when he said he always dreamed of hitting 55 home runs.
I thank God his dream came true.
All those home run hitters are big babies, one after another.
Well,
all righty. Also last night, Giants won, Dodgers lost. San Francisco's magic number is 2. L.A. now 2.5 back with 4 to play. That's sports. I'm Mike Breen.
It's 26.
You have a song for us, right?
Yeah, because you know who's singing the blues today, boy.
Well,
that Marv Albert.
I know that.
Instead of saying yes, he said no.
What is this thing called, though?
This is called You Can't Be Biting on Your Baby Blues.
Why, by the way, is your name blind? You're not blind.
Well, I'm farsighted.
Yeah.
But you can't say farsighted Mississippi White Boy P.P.C.3 because it takes too many letters up on the marquee.
Plus, it would sound stupid, too.
That's a bad good point.
Let's hear this song before this thing just degenerates into absolutely nothing.
Well, if you shut up, I'd get to it.
That's a good point.
Come on, Peepers, bud. Here's a sad, sad story about that kinky little sportscaster mom. Boy had him a sexual appetite. Wasn't exactly kosher palm. He was cheeky and got freaky and it made the evening news. He got them wearing something scanty, got a belt and panties. You can be hungry for some loving, but you can't be biting on your baby blues.
Yeah.
Boy sure did love that threesome, though he wasn't always that discreet.
No.
Asked the girl to bring a pal, some guy named Al who was packing extra meat. Cause a well-hung male transvestite, something Marv just can't refuse. Now we got them big old throbbing wiener, guilty misdemeanor. Girl gonna take him to the cleaner, cause you can't be biting on your baby blue. True pain, I okay, but not when you cross dress. Hope you learned that no means no, even when you were screaming yeah. Cock a flea and made a bargain. Now he lost his cable and his network gig. Cause Dick Ebersol can't be having no commentator who done flipped his wig. One who wear a pair of fishnet stockings and patent leather high heel shoes. Got them no more NFL or embassy, MSG or NBA, career severely DOA. Don't act queer with your fine fiance, cause you can't be biting on your baby.
And you can't be biting on your baby blue. Here on the Imus in the Morning program, it's 16 after the hour. What else is going on, Charles?
Now, Imus in the Morning 2020 Sports. Here's Mark Breen.
Here's a silence howling. Cassie's angels as they fall. And the all-time winner that got him by the ball.
They
Hull-like performance from the L.A. Dodgers. Good morning, Mike Brainwood Sports. Of course, recently Jethro Tull made one of the greatest comebacks in rock and roll history.
Yeah.
A nationwide tour that proved to fans Tull the premier band in music history. Now the Dodgers trying to pull off a great comeback of their own as they took that first start yesterday, beating the Colorado Rockies in Denver 9-5. So L.A. trails by 2 games with 3 to play. Manager Bill Russell says they just need to go out there and focus on what they have to do at hand, and that's to win.
We just need to go out there and focus on what we have to do at hand, and that's to win.
And they've got 3 games to do that, again, in Colorado.
Mike. I'm sorry.
Oops.
I don't know why I said that. Mike, why did you say exactly what Bill Russell said?
Because most sportscasters don't do that, and I want to set myself apart.
But it sounds stupid.
Well, maybe to you, but not to others. I get letters all the time. Fans of Echo Leeds.
Well, I'm not a fan of it. Stop doing it.
All right, fine.
Go ahead.
Clinching last night, Houston wins the NL Central, beat the Cubs 9-1. Mark McGwire making his run at Roger Maris, went into last night's game with the Reds, against the Reds with 55 homers. The game went 14 innings, so he had 6 at-bats. But nothing, no home runs, and he still has 55 with 3 games to play.
Well, why did you give us that big buildup and lead us to believe that something extraordinary had happened?
To bring about disappointment in your life?
Well, you did that by doing a sportscast.
Big NBA trade, 3 teams involved, Seattle, Milwaukee, and Cleveland. Cleveland gets Sean Kemp and Sherman Douglas. Seattle gets Vin Baker. Milwaukee gets Terrell Brandon and Tyrone Hill. The big name, of course, is Kemp, who leaves the Sonics. Seattle coach George Karl had some parting words for Kemp.
I wish him the best. I hope as this settles that he knows that he's a friend of not only myself, but I think he's a friend of the Sonics.
Oh, friend, get out. Go away. As Kemp's career in Seattle is finally over. And the Ryder Cup underway in Spain. The best United States golfers versus the best from Europe. The captain of the USA team is Tom Kite, who spoke of their mission.
We'll play with heart, with pride, and with determination. While at the same time, we will play with respect, integrity, and honor.
Right.
They picked out their what they're going to wear. Red shirts, khaki slacks, tartan sweaters, or white vests, depending on the weather, white shoes, tan hats, and lavender scarves in honor of golf's greatest living player, Don Imus. That's sports. I'm Mike Green.
There's 28 after the hour here on the Imus Morning Program. We'll talk with Brian Williams from NBC.
As my beloved Army's sexual harassment scandal continues to widen and also ascend the chain of command. The active duty officer now facing a Section 286 JIF bomb charge, which, as you know, is the Uniform Code of Military Justice acronym for Get Your F***ing Paws Off Me, is Private, should night those lights and give me the overhead projector. Fine. Cease fire. Jesus. Very well. As I was saying, the individual you see pictured here in silhouette is the highest active duty officer facing a 286 get your f***ing paws off me accusation. Yeah. Now, who can make an identification? Yes, Private?
Sir, accuse me, if you will, of melodramatic embroidery, sir, but the gourd-like calf, the cheese ball nose, the lower lip histrionically drawn over the upper lip in a transparent pretense of courage, well, that's Bill Clinton, sir.
I admire your precision, Private. Load, Pan, Clinton, Jefferson, William, Commander-in-Chief. And according to one of his lawyers, who isn't in jail or under indictment himself, an active duty member of our defense apparatus. Therefore, far too busy leading the free world to be able to respond to the complaint against him from this individual. Identify?
Sir, the tilt-a-whirl hair, the Sears weather beater eyeliner, that my house is metal and has wheels, skin-tight jumpsuit, that's Paula Corbin Jones, sir.
Ground zero again, Private. Corbin Jones, Paula, alleged recipient of an unsolicited short-arm inspection from Mr. Clinton back when the only thing he commanded was the standing militia of Arkansas, whose members salute each other through the familiar right index finger in left nostril presentation. Here is our dilemma. How do we satisfactorily explain to the various drill sergeants and other non-coms who've been accused of sexual harassment that they've got to answer to the charges against them without delay. While at the very top of the chain of command, their self-described active duty ultimate commander gets to do the Dick Morris four-flusher two-timing duck walk around his own pecker mess for at least the next 4 years. Well, it's because of the oldest military acronym in the book, boys. Yeah. Unless the Supreme Court says otherwise, R-H-I-P. What's it mean, men?
Rank half its privileges, sir.
Precisely. Though, on the other hand, it won't exactly be the first active-duty military matter Commander Clinton has managed to avoid. There is a reason, after all, that his two-day pre-inaugural festival is titled An American Journey, and not the Ho Chi Minh Trail. Thank you for your attention. That is all.
You ain't nothing but a hound.
Primus in the morning.
This is today's GT Global Millennium Minute. The countdown is on.
It's September 26th, 1997, 826 days until the year 2000. On this date in 1849, physiologist...
Now, why is he here?
Do you know why he's here?
Well, he's the coordinator of the events.
He sits here and reads a paper all morning. And then I said, but this is our second day here, and I said... You know, I'm trying to cooperate, but one day is enough. People, they like to see us one day. The second day, it's like you've worn out your welcome.
Absolutely.
It's like you've, maybe if I were not sick, it might be better. But
I think we're feeling your pain.
But we're very loyal to WPHT, which is our very fine affiliate here.
Yep.
And they, for some reason, wanted to do this, and we thought they've never had another good idea. They've never had any good ideas, which is why we're on their station.
That was not a good idea either.
So here we are. David Brinkley is going to make his final appearance on this week, Sunday, and it's a show that he created and hosted. He, along with Rune Arledge and Mr. Brinkley, hosted it for 15 years and should have gotten out some time ago.
Yeah.
And didn't. And has been doing these commentaries with Cokie and Sam, and they don't work, and
they pertain to nothing.
They don't yes. They don't. They just get out.
Yeah, it's just time. Thank you, Mr. Brinkley.
And a New York Daily News columnist, Russian Malloy, have asked Peter Jennings about his role in the Marv Albert trial. Jennings reaffirmed that he doesn't know the woman who Roy Black accused of collecting celebrities, including Jennings.
Uh-huh.
He also suggested that for complete coverage of the Albert trial, the columnist tuned to MSNBC. I don't understand that.
I don't either. That Mr. Jennings suggested that?
And Malloy responded, you mean the All Die Network? And Jennings responded, it's the All Marv Network. So, I guess that's a little dig on the part of,
I suppose, yeah.
Mr. Jennings, who has had his problems, but not in the same area that Marv has.
Right.
We don't suspect, do we?
No, of course not. No reason to, no.
No. Now, it's time for the national news, and here with all that stuff is Charles McCord. Good morning, John.
Good morning, I-Man. In some of the late stories this morning, there is still no word on casualties from an airliner crash in Indonesia. Police say more than 220 passengers and crew were aboard the Indonesian Garuda Airlines A300 Airbus, which went down just before it was due to land on the northern tip of Sumatra. There is a heavy haze blanketing Indonesia caused by smoke generated from hundreds of forest fires. Not known if that could have been some sort of factor in the crash. The haze has forced airports in Indonesia to close down, though, from time to time because of lack of visibility. And a close call in the skies over downtown Dallas. A Federal Aviation Administration official says a Southwest Airlines jet, 737, had to take sudden evasive action when a business jet turned right in front of it into its path 2,500 feet over the city. Authorities say the Southwest 737 out of San Antonio was on its final approach into Dallas's Love Field yesterday when a Learjet turned in front of it less than a mile ahead. The Southwest jet went into a sudden climb after its onboard collision alert warning sounded. Preliminary reports indicate the controller in charge of both aircraft at the time may have forgotten somehow that the Southwest jet was there and then turned the Learjet in front of him. A union official, though, says the controller was coming off a very busy period and was overwhelmed. His assault and sodomy trial proved overwhelming, certainly, and yesterday, sportscaster Marv Albert had had enough. Albert pleaded guilty to a misdemeanor assault charge. In exchange, the prosecution dropped the more serious felony charge of forcible sodomy, which could have brought as much as life in prison had Albert been convicted of that. The sportscaster said the trial had gone on long enough.
I just felt that I had to end this ordeal for myself, my wonderful family, fiance Heather, my friends and supporters.
The plea agreement had been offered to Albert prior to the start of the trial, actually. Lead defense lawyer Roy Black was asked if he regretted not accepting it sooner.
The only part that I regret about all these matters is that the rulings under Virginia law that excluded most of our defense. I would think that if all the evidence had been aired, or I knew that it would be, I think our decision-making would have been different.
In his brief public statement, Albert thanked his network, NBC, for standing by him. Hours after the plea was entered, though, NBC fired him. The termination papers signed by NBC's Robert Wright. Albert resigned then from his other broadcasting job with the Madison Square Garden Network. And there is a startling story in this morning's New York Post claiming that Marv had a male transvestite lover for 15 years, and they quote law enforcement sources as they're before the story. The male lover, described as a former Broadway dancer, the man reportedly had been in hiding himself, fearing that he might be called as a witness for the prosecution and concerned that his own double life would be exposed. Marv reportedly had gotten word that...
Maybe that's a Peter Jennings connection.
No,
probably not. That's stupid, isn't it?
That is stupid.
Yeah. Marv reportedly had gotten word that another woman and man were due to testify for the prosecution. The Post says Marv feared prosecution investigators had tracked down the transvestite, and thus he caved in.
Stand by, Larry.
Yeah.
Here's my analysis of this. Roy Black blew the case.
Well...
And now is offering, you know, and there's speculation, and there was somebody had a story that that when this second woman walked in the courtroom, I guess Roy asked Marv if he knew her. Marv said, yeah, but there's nothing happened, of course.
Yeah.
So in essence, Marv was not truthful with... But that New York Post...
Dateline, Philadelphia, Imus in the Morning show. Well, 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 Freedom Fighter, we're not going to get the rest of this particular story, are we? Oh, sure, he's guilty, but there we were, mouth all set. Well, that's unfortunate. Make that eager to get a dose of dirt on who the molar gal pal of Marv Albert was, after all.
Yeah.
Imus himself had promised to tell us, you know, when all of a sudden Liberty Bell Boy was seized by a pang of conscience. Must have been like having a coronary for our fuzzy-headed radio rascal, don't you suppose? I mean, there's an oxymoron, eh? Imus, conscience, like saying Marv, hair. Page two. Well, gullibility buddy, shall we go over the particulars for just a moment? Imus swore to tabloid columnist Sidney Zion, Daily News, that he'd tell us the name of the lady who'd accused Mr. Albert of playing crocodile on her if Sid would tell him. How Sid came by it? Don't know, don't care. But then lady number two stepped up to say Marv had also crocodiled her. And while wearing panties, garter belt, and a chub. Leading credence to the carryings-on of lady number one. After some private deliberations about seemliness and propriety and guidance from professional thumbsuckers, Jeff Greenfield and Mike Barnicle, the I-Man decided to do the right thing. Cave in, denying you and me a wonderful detail of a truly gory story. Well, 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 I guess the I-Man comes up big now, though, doesn't he? The nutshell, Marv guilty, serial biting. Plaintiff's identity is protected, and that oaf, Sid Zion, suddenly owes the salvation of his professional integrity to Don Imus, because when Sid dangled the victim in front of the I-Man the other day, and please forgive me, unlike Marv, the I-Man had the sense not to bite. Page three. And just a final thought or two before we throw a cap on this thing. Didn't you assume, bicuspid chum, that the reason you hired Roy Black, attorney at law, was because you had hoped to walk after you'd been caught with your danskins down? But Roy, do you really believe that when Marv wanted at the end of the day, what he wanted was to go from sportscaster talking to dead man walking? Memo, Marv, to Roy, bite me. Paul Harvey. Good day.
It's a quarter after the hour here on the I'm Just Going program. We'll talk with Brian Williams from NBC News coming up.
Good morning, Mr. Brinkley.
Good morning. How are you?
Let me take you back to 1943 here for just a second. All right, good. It's 1943. You've just gone to work for NBC in Washington. You're looking for a place to live. Who was this announcer at NBC who called in the sack with you?
Well, he's dead now, so I'll tell you. His name is Kenneth Banghart, and he offered to let me rent one of his unused rooms, and I very happily took it. And what happened was that one night in the middle of the night, he tried to crawl into bed with me, and I told him to get out. He said, if I have to get out of my bed, you have to get out of my apartment. So I had to go apartment hunting again.
If your radio sounds funny in the morning, you're listening to Imus in the Morning.
My own son was in school here, and he sang in the choir, singing Christmas carols.
That was Alan, right?
Right, mm-hmm. And the same music critic reviewed them and wrote a very nasty review. And I don't know if I should say this or not, but I said to my wife, that son of a bitch, if I could get my hands on him, I will kill him.
Imus in the Morning. Sports Radio 66,
WFAN. Well, if you're like most folks, if something happened to one of your
kids. Oh, baby, it's time now for Imus in the Morning 2020 Sports. Here's Mark Breen.
High fly ball hit deep to left field. Back goes Husky. Way back it may go.
But did it go? It's time once again to guess the outcome. Good morning, Mike Breen with sports. Bob Murphy, Hall of Famer with the call. But what was the call? You, the listener, can guess the outcome.
Who was it bad?
It doesn't matter.
I want to know.
I don't know.
You're an idiot.
Was it A, a home run, B, caught on the warning track, or C, the ball exploded in midair from a gunshot out of the upper deck? What's your answer? I-Man?
A.
The answer, according to I-Man, is A. So let's pick up the call with Bob Murphy.
Back goes Husky. Way back it may go. Gone, a home run.
And the I-Man is right. The correct answer is A, a home run. If you guessed A, you win a round of golf with the Linkster legend Don Imus, and he wins a round of golf with himself. Congratulations, Don Imus, and all of those out there who guess the outcome.
God, you are an idiot.
Baseball last night, Houston Astros clinched the NL Central, and the L.A. Dodgers stay alive. Astros beat the Cubs, so they're in the playoffs. Dodgers not out of it yet. L.A. wins in Colorado 9-5, so the Dodgers now just two games back of the idle Giants, both teams with three to play this weekend.
Well, doesn't that mean the Giants would have to lose all of their games and the Dodgers have to win all of theirs, or how does that work?
Two out of three. They have to hope the Padres beat the Giants in San Francisco two out of three and the Dodgers win all three.
Oh,
that
okay.
would force a playoff then.
A one-game playoff?
Correct.
God, how great would that be?
Oh, man.
That would be great.
I hope it's fixed so we actually get that, don't you, Chuck?
I absolutely do. Yeah.
And then maybe we could go out and take the show out there and do remote live.
Yeah, maybe like 3 days. It'd be great, huh?
Don't have to worry about doing any playoff remotes in Philadelphia, that's for sure.
Well, why would that be, Marv? I'm not Mike.
Well,
why not keep calling him Marv?
Well, it's on my mind. Yeah, sure.
That's all right, Soupy.
It's a top-of-the-mind thing.
Yeah, that's what it is, yeah.
No problem, Wolfman. Mark McGuire had six at-bats last night in the St. Louis Cardinals' 14-inning loss to the Reds.
Mark
McGuire had no home runs, so McGuire has three games left to hit six just to tie Roger Maris, same for Ken Griffey Jr., who also has 55. NBA trade, the end of an era in Seattle. Sean Kemp is finally dealt a three-team deal with Cleveland and Milwaukee. Kemp will go to Cleveland. Sonics coach George Karl was asked about losing such a great player as Kemp.
I think in a lot of ways our mental health got better today.
Translation, Kemp is a nut. We're glad to get rid of him. As Kemp now goes to the Cavaliers, Sonics get Vin Baker. Milwaukee gets Terrell Brandon and Tyrone Hill.
I don't think that's what he said, Mike.
You have to read between the lines, I-Man.
Well, I know that, but I don't think that was a cut from having anything to do with Sean Kemp, do you?
Yes, it was. For once, I can actually say that was a legitimate cut.
Well, all right.
Sonics get Terrell Brandon and Tyrone Hill. Big NFL game this...
I like these long pauses, Mike. I don't feel well, and you're killing us. I'm pretty much ahead here.
NFL this weekend, one of the big games, the Bengals and the Jets in Cincinnati. Bengals head coach is Bruce Coslett, who, of course, was fired by the Jets several years ago.
Wow.
Coslett was asked if his team can beat the Jets.
I have no idea.
Coslett's team is 1-2. The Jets, of course, are 2-2. And that's sports. I'm Mike Breen.
Thanks for that fine report, Mike, and hopefully we'll be talking to you next hour.
I'll be waiting.
That's kind of your plan, right?
Yes, sir.
It is 25 after the hour. Brian Williams
who I'm fairly annoyed with, frankly.
Yeah.
The more I think about it. But as you know, it's a policy of the I'm Mr. Money program. We don't have anybody on the program who I don't like.
Right.
Or who somebody on the program doesn't like, and usually it's me, but
that's why they're on.
Yes,
sure.
So, we have no point to prove here, obviously. It's just we put people on who we like, and then we go from there.
Mm-hmm.
But, maybe it's because I don't feel well. I think
has a lot to do with today's situation.
This cold now is settled in my chest.
Right.
So I can't breathe. It's hot in here.
Yeah.
And I don't want to be here.
It's annoying, isn't it?
Basically,
yes, it is.
Yes.
But we're with you, all right?
Yeah. Essentially, you suck. But there's some very nice people here, and so we're going to press on,
okay,
to try to finish this as we can.
Do you have the time to listen to me whine about nothing and everything all at once?
I miss in the morning.
Through till earlier this afternoon, have yourself a good one on the fan.
Sports Radio 66, the fan, WFAN.
There's a certain 2020 sports on WFAN, the flagship station for New York Jets football.
Sports Radio 66, the fan.
Radio program. I shouldn't say that, but it's a Christopher Russo radio program for a Saturday morning. Good to have you with us on the 27th day of September, 1997. Good to have you aboard, talking about the world of sports with Joan Chin, Ellen Roberts across the way as we chat about what's cooking. Here at 1 o'clock, a lot of baseball. I'm sure we'll do a little more Robert today as well, and some football. Good to have you aboard. We'll kick it off here this morning at 718-937-6666. We're going to kick it off with the Yankees, who, let's face it, folks, this is an important day.
I'm Paul Olden with the 2020 Sports on WFAN, the flagship station of New York Jets football.
Well, good afternoon to you, and how you be at 2:04, 45 seconds Saturday afternoon on the fan, New York City. Steve Summers here, and you there. Erica Hershkowitz on the other side of the glass.
See, Erica Hershkowitz?
No, Erica Kane. Who do you think we're talking? Ellen Roberts on the other side of the glass.
See, Ellen Roberts?
No, Ellen Barkin. Who do you think we're talking? 718-937-6666 for the Saturday schmooze until the Mets and Braves swing game at 3:35 on the fan, New York. Saul is...
Here now, some of the headline stories we're following for you in the Imus and Washington Network newsroom.
I'm David Brinkley, your program host, most familiar to you from This Week with David Brinkley, seen on most of these stations.
Yeah.
And you're familiar, doubtless, with our regulars, Walter Cronkite, John Donald, the I-Man Imus, Rush Limbaugh, and from time to time, a surprise or two. Now, some news. Damage control at 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue as Zippergate continues to dominate the headlines.
Yeah.
In what observers say was an unprecedented step by a United States chief executive, President Clinton, on advice of counsel Robert Bennett, conducted a startling news conference a short time ago at the White House, hoping to preempt the Paula Corbin Jones sexual harassment case against him and the possibility he might have to submit photographs of his pelvic area. The president and Mr. Bennett called reporters to a bizarre White House photo opportunity. I can recall none like it.
Yeah.
Declaring that there was nothing extraordinary about the presidential penis, as has been alleged by Ms. Jones, the president and Mr. Bennett both removed their trousers and underwear before members of the White House press corps and stood before them in only their shoes and socks, shirts, coats, and ties. The president then addressed the gathered journalists.
Well, now, I hope this puts this whole matter in proper perspective. As you can see, comparing my situation with that of my counsel, Mr. Bennett, here are two perfectly normal, unremarkable, American as apple pie penises. Is something so different about mine from his? Answer, no. Am I right, Bob? No Mr. Happy Face, no White House or bust tattoo, nothing.
No disrespect intended, sir, but it would be helpful if we could obtain a shot of you gentlemen, with your,
Yeah, I know what you're trying to say, and I feel your pain. You'd like some shots of Mr. Bennett and myself in a state of,
Right, yes, sir.
Well, we can do that. If y'all would step outside, we'll call you back in shortly. Except for, Miss Woodruff, Ms. Roberts, and Ms. Root.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
And some related items as controversy persists in the Clinton administration. Among those weighing in on the latest problems for the first family, gadfly and frequent Clinton critic H. Ross Perot, who was asked about the Corbin-Jones matter during his latest appearance on the Larry King Live program on CNN.
Larry, I take no pleasure in this. It's just sad. I gave the people a chance to elect Perot, and what'd they do? Called me a little you heard it. And now what do we got on our hands? A presidency that just darn well may come tumbling down over the very same thing. A little All I can tell you is that I'm looking toward 96, because Perot can promise you this much, Larry, you and the people. I know when and where to keep my shorts on. As I like to put it now, united we stand, and you won't see my gland. Just that simple.
But just know that rather, in this CBS coverage of the funeral of Princess Diana, is going to do something. First of all, to start weeping. And there is the potential for him to throw himself on the casket, screeching and weeping.
And then
clutching it as they drag it down the street.
Saying,
his kids trying to beat him up.
Screaming no. And then to be rolled away in a white coat with his arms folded, tied behind him on a hand dolly like Hannibal Lecter.
Tape him up solid, lady, die.
If your radio sounds funny in the morning, you're listening to Imus in the morning.
My brother, Fred Imus. Don't you like Coach Parcells?
He's not running with the ball. He's not taking any snaps.
Well, you're an idiot. You just don't get it, possum face.
You pig-eyed bag.
Pig-eyed bag?
Wait a minute.
Maybe he does get it.
Yeah, no, I get it.
Guy gets on there with leather and scarves. You don't think I get it?
No, I get it. I'll talk to you later.
I'll tell you what I'm doing.
What?
I'm getting a lock put on my bedroom next time you're out here.
Oh, man.
Matt Millen, the interruption.
Well, San Francisco goes into Carolina and beats up on the Panthers 34-21. Niners get a good game from the human concussion, Steve Young, who ran for one touchdown, threw for another. Panthers linebacker Lamar Lathan couldn't believe his team's performance.
I think this is the first time that I can honestly say, and I'll always say this after the game, a team, what we did out there, the team was more physical than us tonight.
Okay. Sound like Mitch Blood Green
from the courthouse. Yeah. God, 49ers now 4-1.
Oh, New York Giants.
Hey, if I get on a jury, Bernie,
yeah,
I'll have you cover the trial.
Yeah.
Because I'm not going to be able to report on the trial, obviously.
Right.
Probably I wouldn't blurt something out. Well, no, if they told me not to, I wouldn't.
Well, of course not.
Right.
Play by the rules.
Yeah, sure.
Well, what time do you have to be down there today?
9 o'clock.
What time's that hot dog stand open?
No.
Well, how would I know?
A lot of them have breakfast sausages, you know.
No. This is a picture in that I could just as easily have been walking by a liquor store. But you weren't. Well, the hot dog stand is on the corner there. Why are you eyeing the Stanford or something? I got sunglasses on. How can you tell what I'm eyeing? I'm not eyeing anything. Well, why do you have your wallet out? That's not my wallet. I don't carry a wallet. That's my cell phone.
Calling for your ATM card.
New York Giants rookie running back Peaky Barber out for a couple of weeks, so Tyrone Wheatley will start Sunday against the Cowboys. Wheatley's an easygoing, pleasant chap who shared his philosophy of running with a group of school kids.
I respect no one, man. Hell, I mean, if I'm trying
trying to go where I'm trying to go, and you're in my way. I got to put you down, and that's just the way I take it.
Hey, Dad. Jesus. NFL needs more attitudes like that.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah. Thank you, Tyrone. Baseball playoffs are here. They begin today. Right. Astros and Braves in Atlanta. Braves, of course, the huge favorite there, but Astros manager Larry Durker is all fired up.
You know, it's a game. You go out there and play, and we think we've got a chance.
Well, not exactly Newt Rockne, but apparently that'll do for the Astros.
Well,
107 Eastern time, first pitch there.
He's not wrong about it, is he?
No, he's not.
Well, what do you want?
Oh, great. I'll be sitting out there in jury duty, and I got a baseball game. So
that's right.
That's great.
Adding to the burden here.
Yeah. Crying out loud. Giants and Marlins will be in Florida. That's a 4:07 Eastern time first pitch.
Maybe the hot dog guy have the TV set up.
That will be fine. Most of them do have those little things.
Yeah, they do.
So you can have lunch while you're watching a game.
No. There's no lunch. What are you talking about, the lunch?
A quick lunch.
They
go to lunch from, what'd you say, from 12 to 2 or 1?
And, you know, I try to be cooperative with the photographers and these other people.
Well, I mean, but why not?
But I wasn't buying a hot dog. I was walking by it. How can I help that?
Oh, ironic.
And what do they do? Right. You try to cooperate, what do? They hose you.
Well, it appears that way.
They've trapped you.
Yes, they did. That's actually now how Princess Diana must have felt.
Absolutely.
Driven to her death, and I've been driven to, well,
suicide? Maybe?
Well, what, Bernie?
Keep hope alive.
It's coming up on 26 after the hour. What else? Tonight, it's the Indians and Yankees in the Bronx. You'll be able to watch that if you all finish your jury duty by then.
Yeah. Right.
Yankee manager Joe Torre was asked for his starting lineup.
Raines, Jeter, O'Neill, Williams, Martinez, Curtis, Boggs, Girardi, Sanchez.
All right.
Right.
In case you missed any of the starters, here's Torre again.
Raines, Jeter.
No. We don't want to hear the starters again. Well, some people like to fill out their scorecard early.
Well, they can watch tonight.
While others do other things during the day.
It is 26 after the hour. And I am Imus Wayne. The priest and rabbi are going to be here this morning because Rosh Hashanah is.
Yeah. And you need them, by the way. You probably need a little spiritual guidance since you approach your civic duty.
Well, You shouldn't, in fulfilling your civic duty, part of the deal shouldn't be that you're held up to public ridicule.
Right.
As being portrayed in the newspaper this morning as a juror reject.
Or
any moron can get on a jury.
Or it's subjected to ambush photography, for crying out
absolutely
loud, by the paparazzi.
That shows you, you know, in an area that you didn't want to be seen in.
No.
And you know they knew that.
They listen.
No, of course they listen.
The U.S. Open hot dog history.
Yeah, I'm walking by a hot dog stand.
You never see that.
Tell me about it.
Well, I mean, there's
no, that's where they could have shot you anywhere, I meant.
Mm-hmm.
Well, no, they can't see the car behind. I had just gotten out of the car, mm-hmm. and Rocco's to the left of me there, and he and I are walking in the courtroom.
Why did they get you as you were emerging from the car before you reached that particular point where they would see you staring?
They were all over taking pictures of Mike Tyson and Mitch Green. So, they didn't spot the I'm in until I was unfortunately standing right next to the hot dog stand.
Delicious beef frankfurters.
Sylvia!
Yes, Mickey?
How you call your lover boy?
Come here, lover boy.
And if he doesn't answer?
Oh, lover boy.
$1 million
to United Nations charities. Okay, go ahead.
Not exactly.
Larry asked him if he had talked it over with his wife, Jane Fonda. And Ted says, well, yes, we're in a hotel room, and I told her what I was going to do, and she got tears in her eyes, and she said, I'm so proud to be married to you.
Oh, man.
That happened to me once in a hotel room. I told her what I was going to do, and she got tears in her eyes, too.
Radio sounds funny in the morning. You're listening to Imus in the Morning.
Good morning, Fred.
Anything new in your life that I need to know about?
Getting ready to build my chicken coop. Getting 3 chickens.
Back when my brother and I were growing up back on the ranch, my brother, and this is very difficult to do, by holding a chicken a certain way on his lap,
right,
could actually make the chicken smile.
That is quite a feat.
Right,
yep.
Nobody wanted to eat it, but...
Though it had been basted.
When it gets good, you just split their neck off.
Sports Radio 66, WFAN.
Rubble,
in the last
I resent that.
I don't think he was referring to the IMF.
How come I don't know about these appearances here? Why come out on my sheet here?
Well, we try to put them on closer to the date because it irritates the IMF if they're
on. No, it doesn't. No, well, I don't mind promoting yourself at all.
You're the mayor.
So you can't go to the Promise Keepers rally?
Unfortunately...
Lou, what are you doing this weekend?
I'm committed. I'll think of something.
She's going to wash the socks. Why is my friend Patricia Ireland and the rest of these people all hysterical about the people from the Promise Keepers guys? What is that all about? What the... On what basis?
They feel that it represents... I don't know. It's hard for me to figure out, but I guess it's because it just generally to these people represents a right-wing philosophy or agenda.
Paranoid.
That's about all I can think
of. Well, that's not what they say. I'm sure that's part of it.
Yeah.
But they'd be a little slicker than to say that, I think. If I understand it. But some women's aversion to Promise Keepers. Promise Keepers.
We don't smoke marijuana in Muskogee.
Columnist, you go back to the Globe tomorrow and they say, by the way, no Kennedys anymore.
Right, well, there's no Globe anymore without no Kennedys.
There you go.
Yeah, well,
How can you run the Stanford Daily by saying there's an absolute rule of no Chelsea Clinton unless something, you know...
Well, first of all, it sounds to me, with no disrespect intended, that perhaps the editor of the Stanford Daily, as well as Jesse, I read the column, perhaps ought to switch their majors from journalism to engineering. Something else is boring, because they ain't getting the job done with the way they're doing it. I don't know whether the intent on the part...
What do you mean by that exactly, Mike?
Well, Jesse, I don't know whether your intent was to aggravate the editor. If it was, there's certainly far better ways to aggravate editors than to going right against their stupid orders not to put the name Chelsea in the paper. There were far better column topics that you could have come up with. You could have picked perhaps the poorest student who arrived that particular day, perhaps by bus or train from some far-off point, and contrast that student's arrival with Chelsea's arrival. In other words, I think, you know, maybe the job is to think more about entertaining or informing the reader rather than titillating yourself and aggravating your editor. I don't know. That's just my view.
Well, a fairly vicious, but not the most vicious attack of this child, of this poor, innocent, fat little child from from the Stanford College newspaper. But there is another cut to cut that follows that cut.
Flamethrower.
In which Barnacle essentially, pardon my language, but bitch slapped his poor child. And do they have that available, I wonder?
If it's news, you put it in the paper. I mean, Chelsea getting up, having breakfast, going to class, that's not news.
And that's not what I wrote, Mike. I mean, I wrote about the fact that the President of the United States and the First Lady of the United States were on this campus and how students here were affected by their presence and would be affected by them coming to visit in the future.
Jess, again, with all due respect, I read what you wrote, and there was a touch to it of trying to tell someone's parents how to raise their child and what they ought to do with their child. That they happen to be the Clintons has very little to do with it. What we need less of in this business that you want to be a part of is meanness and cynicism and smart-alecky. We certainly have enough of that to go around, and it's the easiest thing in the world to do.
Let me take a call from Orlando relevant...
Also, fairly another ugly exchange. So now this poor child sitting there with his pants probably damp.
Yeah, no.
Being pummeled by the big bully from the Boston Globe,
shriveling before our eyes.
Yeah,
little fella.
And all the fat little fella tried to do, and he had a pretty good idea. And the essence of his column, as I understand it, was that how were these other parents who were bringing their children to Stanford supposed to enjoy what would normally be a normal first day for their kids?
Yeah.
Probing the dark recesses of our national media's nether regions, veteran broadcast journalist Walter Cronkite.
And bent across our media watch examining table today, awaiting the inquiring forefinger of this old investigator of the inept, the flaccid, flabby form of television's most egregious insult to intelligence ever, Keith Olbermann, the new host of the new program, The Big Show, on MSNBC, whose debut offering, in the estimation of this keen observer of mediocrity, if I may coin a term, was the single worst image a television camera has ever been allowed to transmit. First and foremost, of course, there is Mr. Olbermann, a truly repugnant, unctuous man, who somehow has convinced himself, probably through some weird body-piercing ritual, that he is smart and entertaining. Well, he is neither. What he is stupid and suffocatingly tedious, with the strained on-camera presence of someone who is trying desperately to stifle a huge fart. Olbermann today to MSNBC's Big Show from ESPN's SportsCenter program and would enjoy a larger audience at either venue by taking a Polaroid photograph of himself and showing it door to door to residents of his apartment building. That is, if anyone would open the door to Mr. Olbermann. I note here that the physical resemblance to the late Andrew Cunanan is not inconsequential. Is Keith Olbermann that way? We won't ask and he won't tell. However, when one peers even momentarily into those troubled eyes, it requires no great leap of imagination to see ladies' undergarments there. No, we feel that, as with some other sports broadcast figures, Keith would not be averse to wearing something that makes him feel pretty. Olbermann says he departed ESPN for MSNBC because sports has become, in his words, a big, foul-smelling pit that wears you down reporting about it. I was convinced, he droned on, that if I was on SportsCenter another year, I'd tell owners and players to go to hell or have a nervous breakdown, or both. Well, in that case, Keith, if only you'd have stayed another year and a half, perhaps suicide could have become an option, rather than having it become an option now for your audience, such as it is. What a truly, truly horrific program. Closing thoughts? The new television content rating system is now in effect, adding letter designations for sexual depictions, violence, crude language, and the like. May I suggest a designation specifically for Mr. Olbermann's show? TS, for warning, this sucks. Further, while I'm certain it was not by design, it seems at least unwittingly appropriate that the Big Show's debut coincided with the start of Rosh Hashanah, which concludes with Yom Kippur, because somebody somewhere is going to have to atone for this outrage until the sun explodes, or until Michael Eisner pays Jeffrey Katzenberg, whichever comes first. Yes, Imus in the morning, and now Olbermann in the evening. The only possible conclusion? The wheel of the National Broadcasting Company has been seized by Henri Paul, and he's faced. MSNBC, AWFUL. For Media Watch, this is Walter Cronkite. Thank you and good night.
Here's what you do not want to see in the paper is your mugshot from another case.
And then Marv Albert tied to dead dominatrix.
I mean, she got God almighty, that headline.
Just, I mean, oh, man, go back to sleep.
No, I mean, you just say to you, but you don't want that.
I don't ever want to see that. I don't want my face and my number there to be next to McCord tied to dead dominatrix. No. Right. From Bible to bridal, McCord is...
If your radio light sucks in the morning, you're listening to Imus in the Morning.
According to one of the dominatrixes, my clients are your neighbors. They're your doctors, your lawyers, your teachers.
Your newsmen.
Your newsmen. And your sportscasters who have a dark side.
Yeah. Your sidekicks.
Time you check.
It's time now for Imus in the Morning 2020 Sports.
Here's Mark Breen.
Here's the 1-0 pitch, a swing and a high fly ball well hit to right field, and back goes Sheffield, and this ball is gone.
Exciting playoff action. Good morning, Mike Breen with Sports. Hank Greenwell with the call. As the Florida Marlins do it again.
He must be announcer for the Giants, right?
No, he's actually doing it for CBS Radio.
Hmm. So he's trying to go right down the line, I suppose.
Well, yeah, but I mean, God. Well, there's no Don Kirk here, Vin Scully, or anybody, is he?
I don't think so.
Get a little more excited.
Oh, yeah.
Mm.
I'm going to beat the Giants on a ninth-inning game-winning hit. Moises Alou did it this time, with the Marlins up 2-0. Now the series shifts to San Francisco. Moises was asked what they hope to accomplish there.
We are going there and trying to win the thing.
They are. Game 3 will be tomorrow in San Francisco. Huh. Last night, Seattle Mariners get ripped 9-3 by the Orioles. Baltimore taking game 1 of that best-of-5 series. Bad day for Ken Griffey Jr. and his team. Griffey's had a couple of bad days recently. Last day of the regular season, he hit his 56th home run, so he wanted the ball to save. A little memento. Guy who caught that special home run had his 14-year-old daughter with him, a young girl who idolizes Griffey. Perfect fit, right? Wrong. Griffey and the family get into an argument in the parking lot after the game. 14-year-old calls him a loser.
Yeah.
Couldn't decide on how much the ball was worth. Yeah. Trying to negotiate a little deal there. Which is always...
Tried to sell a ball to him?
Yeah, or get some kind of autographed baseball, etc.
Oh, come on.
Call him a loser.
Loser.
Hey, you loser. Get out.
Guy just hit 56 home runs.
Loser.
He's a loser.
He sucks. The guy's daughter.
Right.
Yeah. Interesting girl. Yeah,
the little girl calling him a loser.
Yeah, loser.
Atlanta beat Houston 13-3.
Well, the thing's most offensive is they're trying to sell the ball back to Kent, right?
Yeah.
Jesus, God.
What's it worth to you?
Oh, man, come on. Since then, they brought the girl, came in, he sat in the locker room with him for like a two-hour chat, and he gave him autographed jersey.
Oh, okay, so there's a...
But he still doesn't have the ball.
Oh, okay, well,
it's golden.
Still negotiating that deal.
That's right, the lawyers are now at it.
Yeah, they're trying to work that over.
Oh, baby, what's up?
Teaching his daughter the fine art of negotiations.
Oh, man, ugly.
Terrible.
Well, the Yankees are going to play tonight. That should be a pretty good game. It's on Fox, and... We get to have McCarver be interrupted by the annoying, who's the other guy?
Bob Brenly?
Yeah.
Bob Brenly.
And,
Joe Buck.
Or... Equally annoying, Joe Buck.
You ain't nothing but a hound dog.
Or not. You see, I honestly don't know if it is during this time or simply on Yom Kippur itself, the Day of Atonement.
I think they can answer the phone.
I think, that can't they during this period leading up to Yom Kippur, so...
We have one we can call. We have Joel's number.
Yes, we do.
Let's dial it up.
Okay.
See.
Right.
See if he answers.
All right.
Calling the general manager of the radio station, Joel Hollander, who is Jewish.
Mm-hmm. The general Jew.
The general Jew. See if he answers the phone. Isn't this a Day of Atonement?
Well, no, the actual Day of Atonement is Yom Kippur, but this is the period. This is the 10-day high holiday. This is the period during which Jewish people do reflect on the year just past and see mistakes they've made and so on, and atone and make plans to do better.
Right. Well, we'll see what he's done so far, just a few hours into the holiday. So I would call my agent, Esther Newberg, but we know she'd answer the phone.
Oh, absolutely.
She's probably having a breakfast meeting.
She wears one of those little headsets with the phone thing on, so just hits that hit a button.
With one of her lesbian authors.
There you go.
The hound is on home now. Leave a message after the beep.
Great. Please don't have our idiot children pick the phone. We know you're
Come
there.
On.
Pick it out of tone and for nothing. Pick the phone up.
Pick up the phone.
One of you Jews pick the phone up. Come on.
Unless you're out buying bacon or something.
Pick the phone up. Why is it necessary to have our children on our answering machines?
I don't know.
Well, I did run ours, so.
Well, there's your answer.
That's the answer.
Yeah.
It's coming up on 9 minutes after the hour, and, one successful. So, sort of.
Yeah. I mean, if you really were observing the holiday, we had the answering machine turned off, and it would have run.
Well, no, I think it's okay to have the answering machine on.
I don't know. It's splitting hairs, I'll admit, but I think if I were... I think I would have the answering machine turned off and the ringer turned off.
Yeah. Coming up here in just a minute, this is great. Bill Clinton and Paula Corbin Jones with Arkansas Nights from Greece.
Yeah.
And it was called something else in Greece, but it's an adaptation of that. So it's Weasel.
Get to the bottom of this one.
Maybe.
Hi. Leave a message and I'll get back to you.
It's Imus, the little shrimp.
Oh,
and,
No. I don't think that's necessary.
Hey, good morning.
Good morning, Miss Dowd.
That's better.
It's Mr. Imus, and we're leaving this message on your machine and on the radio. And I'd like to know why you gratuitously attacked me, backhanded me yesterday in this feminist rant column of yours about Anita Hill, and I resent the fact that you're not returning my telephone calls. You have my number. It's 718-706-7690, and I expect you to call me.
All you've done.
All I've done for you.
Darn right.
We're leaving a message here because we don't have Kwesi Mfumi's home number.
By the way, Miss Dowd, I hope you're feeling better.
Yes.
It's, okay, hang on. It's 14 after the hour here on the Mr. Wayne program. That's kind of an interesting message she leaves, isn't it?
It's really happy.
Oh, hi. Leave a message. You know, 70 years old.
You look like you're 82 years old.
No, I don't. I look very good. 17 after the hour.
You look good enough for an open casket.
That's great. That's great karma to wish me dead all the time.
I didn't. I just...
Well, yeah, you do. Okay, fine. It's fine. That's fine. Here now, Bill Clinton and Paula Corbin Jones.
I swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. So help me God.
Southern lover had me some fun.
He was governor in May 91.
Met a girl, made my knees knock.
Dropped his pants, showed me his little rock.
caught in detail.
Tell the court, did he make you inhale? The state trooper brought me upstairs.
She was super, man, what a pair.
Made a pass, wanted a kiss.
I pinched her ass, told her to kiss this.
He was so rude on that, that Arkansas night.
Well, well, well,
tell the court, did you two both embrace?
Tell the court, did she have to use mace?
He's impulsive, a hideous brute.
She's repulsive, how'd I think she was cute?
I've been dissed throughout my crusade.
I'll tell you this, I didn't get laid.
Not a prude, but I know a slewd on that, that Arkansas night. Tell the court, is it just politics?
Tell the court, can she ID your penis?
He made an offer, but Susan said no.
Didn't boffer, though she was a ho-ho-ho.
Legal counsel, they took a hike.
She turned me down. She's probably a dyke.